Good morning. Good morning, Austin Knows. How's everybody doing out there? Yeah, I got my glasses on so I can see everybody. So I can see if y'all are clapping. Who wants to sing today? Ooh, and we have a crowd of folks coming in. Yeah, let's sing. So we're going to sing. We're caffeinated. Check, check. All the wildflowers are out, y'all. Amazing. This is such a beautiful time in the year. God is good. I love to see his creation out and about. We are going to praise God and sing and clap loudly and make some joyful noise. So let's go ahead and stand and let's do this, y'all.
The king who conquered the grave, worthy is. All of you, Lord. For your mercy never fails me. Oh, my days, I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Come on, every voice.
All my life. Of the goodness of God.
And God, you're so good. Oh God, you're so good. God, you're so good. You're so good to me. And we'll tell him this morning that he's good. Oh God, you're so good.
Both now and forever.
Has he been good to you?
Oh God,
have you seen a glimpse of his goodness of all your life? Oh, sing these words to him.
God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Oh, I have seen your God. I have seen your goodness,
God. You're so good.
And I want to declare to you that you are good.
Oh God, you're so good.
Tell him this morning,
God.
Sing it one more time, one more last time. God, you're good.
God, you're so good. God, you're so good.
Oh, God,
you're so good.
You're
so good to me.
This is truth. We're singing, God, on top of our lungs. We're saying that you are good because we've seen your goodness. You've always been good. Even when it seemed like we were going through the darkest valley of the shadow of death, you were still good, always by our side. And we just want to tell you that we know that. We appreciate your goodness. Thank you, my God. Thank you, Jesus. Give you all the praise in your precious name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Amen, church. You can turn to your neighbor and welcome them to church, and then after that, you can have a seat.
Good morning, church. Welcome to Austin Oaks. If you're new, a guest with us this morning, we are really excited and thankful to have you. My name is Chad McCartney. I'm one of the pastors here on staff, and we would love to help you find out more about who we are at Austin Oaks Church. And you can do that through a connection card. But here's what I want to do. You can follow along, but here's what I need all of you to do. And you may never hear this happen again at church, so you're here to participate in it. But I need you to get your phone out. Everyone get your phone out. Hold it up in the air like this. Come on, this is how we're going to welcome Brandon up onto the... I'm kidding, we're not. Get your phone out. Now, you're going to see on the seat in front of you, there's a little QR code. I want everyone here to scan that QR code. Just go to your camera. If you're new to this, go to your camera, scan it. And what you're going to see on there is both our connection card if you're a guest, but you're going to see all of our announcements as well, which is just another example of how technology is making my job irrelevant. So you really don't need to hear me do anything else after this, but I'm going to share it with you anyway. So that's there. That QR code every single week will tell you what's going on and what's coming up, and it's going to give you the details to it so that we don't have to talk about details up here. But let me run through some of the key things that are happening. Women in our church, we have a women's brunch, kind of a mixer for you coming up in a few weeks. The details, again, are on the website there, but you'll see them on the slide. This is open to all of you. Brunch is going to be provided. It's a great opportunity for the women of every generation in our church to get together and just have great fellowship and make connections and relationships. Also, we have a number of opportunities for some next steps in people's lives coming up. So we have a parent-child dedication class coming up. So if you have a recent child and you want to dedicate, or you as parents want to just be dedicated and prayed over for the raising up of that child, we have that coming up. Information, again, is on there. If you want to be baptized, both adult and children, we have a class coming up that will walk through what that looks like, that will help parents talk to their kids about baptism. If they are ready and you feel like they're getting ready to take that step, we would love to walk with you on that journey. So you can sign up through the website on that card as well. And then lastly, Discover AOC is coming up next week. We've had lots of guests coming in the last few weeks. Discover AOC is like your very first simple introduction to who we are as a church. Kind of gives you a 30,000-foot view and helps you understand who we are and why we do what we do. And so next Sunday, right after the service, if you go out these back doors into that glass room called the Oaks Room, we will have that. It's like 15 minutes, just gives you a big picture. We would love to have you and host you if you're guests and you're new, and you just want to find out a little bit more about who we are as a church and what that looks like for you. So at this time, I'm going to turn your attention to the screen for a testimony.
I'm Amanda Larner, and I've been coming to this church since I was in fourth grade, so just about 24 years. The playground had just been built, and I remember that was the whole reason why I wanted to come to this church, for the cool playground that had a climbing wall. Growing up in the youth ministry, doing middle school and high school, I loved it. I found a community there. I came here every week for Sunday and for Wednesday Bible studies and lock-ins here at the church. I just loved it. When I graduated from high school, I did what most teenagers do and rebelled a little bit. I had a really rough summer of making a lot of bad choices, a lot of bad decisions. And at my lowest point, I just really hated who I was and what I was doing. And I didn't really have anywhere else to go besides following God. And it wasn't until a few years after that that I realized that my life was drastically different. It was a clear difference between who I was before I made that choice and who I was after. And I got to really give back and help in the youth ministry every summer. I interned here with the youth ministry, and then I was able to get a job full-time after I graduated college, which I loved and just had a complete blast. I also met my husband here when we were in middle school. We were in the same youth group. He did not have any idea that I existed, but we became friends and started dating in college, and pretty soon after we graduated, we got married. we've had a lot of this church community pour into our lives as we were dating, as we got married, and now as we have kids and are raising two incredibly wild boys. And it's really just so incredibly special for us to get to raise our kids here at Austin Oaks in this place where we both have had so many great experiences, and to get to see how God is working within the community here at Austin Oaks Church.
Good morning, church family. Man, I love hearing stories of how God reaches one generation and another generation and another generation, because the story of God's always going to be told through the changed lives of people. And that's the thing that I love, and what I want to talk about this morning is that our God is a generational God. Psalm 145 has this beautiful declaration that one generation will tell of your good deeds, your works to another generation. So I wanted to just kind of like help us paint the picture that what we do and who we are today isn't just by random chance, that we're just here because we choose to be here, all that kind of stuff. But this has been a move of God for many, many, many years. And Amanda Larner and her husband and her family that's growing up is just part of that story. And we are all part of this story that sort of originated in the late 1800s. You see, in the late 1800s in this area, a bunch of Swedes, they became passionate for Jesus. And they gathered together and they started to do these like tent revival meetings in this area. And a lot of people gave their faith or gave their life over to him. And around 1892, a group of Swedes out of that area, they ended up purchasing a 1-acre plot of land in Decker. And that church started to form. They had 33 members. A congregation was established. They were praying, longing to see God made much of, longing for people to meet, know, and follow Jesus. And in 1904, a group broke from that, went to Elroy, and they planted another church. And that church started out strong with 16 members, and they became a praying church. And around 1923, this church merged with another church in the city of Austin, and they decided to link arms with the Evangelical Free Church, the denomination, but they were known as the Swedish Free Church of Austin. And in May 16th of 1925, which is kind of cool to think about because next year, that means this is a 100-year anniversary, which is really cool and awesome to be part of such a story. In May 16th, 1925, as they joined and linked hands with two churches and a denomination, they built a building on Colorado, and they also grew to 200 members. And next thing you know, they started to realize that, oh my goodness, the people in Austin, they just don't simply speak the Swedish language. Because church at that time was just in Swedish. Right? Like that's the language they had. And they started to realize like so many people around us in our present context, they don't speak English. And so if they were to enter into our church, man, they would need an interpreter. And so they decided to do two things in 1930, just to keep moving with the Spirit of God. They decided, hey, one, let's speak English. And there was a cost to be paid in that. Some folks in the church probably didn't know English all that well, and so they learned the language, and all of a sudden the church became an English-speaking church. But also they changed their name, because no longer are they just going to be the Swedish Free Church. They are now the First Evangelical Free Church. And due to circumstances, they had to relocate, and in 1961, they built a building which we common here on 45th and Red River, which is where God started to do some beautiful things. And since 1965, as they were there, the church has seen so many different stories, so many different moments, so many different seasons, seasons of sowing, seasons of reaping, highs and lows, times of growth, times of pruning, all of the stuff that happened. And all of a sudden, around 1990, the church looked around, and all of a sudden they realized, hey, we're pretty similar. We're all about the same age. And they realized that the younger generations weren't part of their church. They were having a hard time reaching out and declaring the works to an emerging generation. And there was roughly anywhere between 45 to 60 people left in that church. And they began to pray fervently. And they were kind of forced to two decisions. Either A, one, we close up shop, we sell the property and give the money over to the denomination to bless another church. Or B, we pray and trust and live in the perhaps that God is still on the move. And so that group of people, they began to pray and pray and pray for revival, pray for a new awakening to happen within their church. And they took a risk by inviting the next pastor, and through that church and through the next leadership and through their predetermined yes to God, God began to do a work in that church. And then around 2000, they came here to 4220 Monterey Oaks, which at this point, there was nothing around here. Look at that picture. Nothing around. They came. This was kind of like on the outskirts. And in, let me get the right date here because I don't want to miss it, because there are folks who were there back then be like, you totally butchered that date. 2000, October, they broke ground. And if Scott Krieger is here, I would tell him, regrow that goatee, buddy. 2002, Palm Sunday, was the first time they opened the doors and had a worship service here. And for years, God started to do a work here through a people in a specific place, all wrapped around the same mission, the same mandate, the same ambition that has been always part of this church. In fact, even in 2014, they decided to change the name so that way they can tell another compelling contextual story to the city of Austin. Transition, seasons of high, seasons of low, seasons of growth, reaping, sowing, pruning, all of the things. And even today, we still carry some of the very same DNA that was at the very core of the beginning of this church, which is to be a church that's simply all about Jesus, that is laser focused on multi-generational discipleship, a church that is passionate and absolutely committed to declaring to the emerging generations that Jesus is worth it. And I just like look at some of these pictures that happened during Holy Week in our church, and they're absolutely beautiful. I just have three as an example of just seeing some of the multi-generational stuff that has happened. I love this picture of an older lady in our church, relatively older. Okay, she's here. She's like, what, who are you calling old? Relatively older to the sweet little girl washing her feet. Church, is this not what it's about? Then you see a family washing each other's feet. Father, mother, son, daughter. And then just seeing a revitalized and beautiful worship service where we have multi every generation worshiping together. And it's such a beautiful picture because we got little girls in there all the way to the older generation. It is just beautiful, declaring the glories of our Lord and Savior. Every marker in the history of Austin Oaks Church, every season, every chapter, the people who have called this church their home, they have constantly and struggled and strive and pursued to live in the perhaps, which I know is a very confusing phrase, but get used to it. You don't use this phrase often, living in the perhaps. But it's another way of saying it's living by faith, but a certain type of faith. It's a faith that rests on the character and the heart of God, even when the future or when the next steps aren't crystal clear. It's living in the perhaps. I'm going to move forward because I know who God is. I know his character. I know his heart. And I know his desires. Even though I don't know exactly every step of the way going forward, I am going to move forward. And I'm going to accept with a predetermined yes, whatever it is that God lays out before us. If he changes courses, if he changes directions, if he changes plans, I am saying yes. That's what it means to live in the perhaps. Every chapter that God has written, is writing, and will write here at Austin Oaks Church will always involve faith. It will always involve a people to live in the perhaps because of God's given purpose to this church. God has been at work. He's still at work. And sometimes that work looks different. Not every season, at every moment looks the same. We look at scriptures, you got pruning seasons, you got explosive revival seasons, you got seasons where it's just preparing the way for something to come. You got ups and downs, everything. And so the church shouldn't be confused or deceived or manipulated to think that God isn't at work by what we see externally. As we've seen in Revelation, God is in the midst of his church. He sees and he knows all and he cares. He will speak love, he will speak truth, sometimes hard truth, but he's at work. And here's the part that I love about this church. Ever since the late 1800s, it's been a church that has been absolutely captivated by Jesus. A people fervent in prayer, daring to love others because Christ loves, willing to give generously, to live sacrificially, to pursue uncommon unity. It's absolutely beautiful. Every generation so far in this church has been simply about one thing, and it's been contextualized in different chapters, but it's ultimately for the glory of God, to exalt the name of Jesus. That's the end goal. That's the ambition. That's why we exist as a church. For no other reason than that, we exist to be simply about Jesus, to lift high his name, because he's the one that people have to encounter. He's the one who's at the center of all things. He alone is worthy. He alone is beautiful. He alone is in control of all things. It's all about Jesus. And if it's all about him, then it's important for us as a church to know what he's up to in and through the church. And we've seen in Revelation, as we've been in that series, that he's making a people, a kingdom of priests to my God, right? To live for the glory of his name and to then minister or to serve to people who are yet to love him. That's the end goal. That's the ultimate purpose. That is the ambition of every church that bears the name of Jesus Christ. It's just contextualized differently in each church. Now, that end goal is of the greatest value, is the greatest importance, not the means, not the how we do things. Even though the means of what we do and how we do it matter, it's the end goal that ultimately matters. Because if you have Jesus at the center and you are simply about Jesus and you love him, friends, I'm telling you, the means start to fall into place. Unless the Lord builds it, we labor in vain. If we want to be a vibrant church, a dangerous church, we have to be focused on the mission, on the purpose, on the end goal. To be a church that's willing to be all things to all people in order to win some for Jesus. This goal, this end is about love. It's about a relationship. Jesus wants people to love him. He wants a people to receive his love with great joy. It's about people. And because it's about people, it's about sacrifice. How can you love someone if you don't sacrifice? Love immediately says, I am going to limit my liberty for the sake of another. It's about joy, life. For the church to be focused on this mission, it requires a people in a place, in this present moment, to be devoted to Jesus, to each other, and devoted to the mission at all costs, which is living in the perhaps. It requires a people at this present moment in this place who know and understand what's at stake if we do not give God our predetermined yes. Since 1892 to 2024, April 7th, right? The mission's been the same. And we believe as a church that there's so much more because of Jesus. We believe that the best is yet to come. We believe that God can and will do more than all we can ask or imagine as we continue to say yes and walk with him. Whatever it is, Lord, for your name and renown, we are in. Jesus, yes. If it helps us reach other people to know you so they can love you, yes. If it exalts you, yes. We are being invited, church, by the Holy Spirit in this present season to live in the perhaps, to live and to walk by faith, to believe that God desires to do something significant in this church and in your life and in the lives of those who have yet to know Jesus. But more than anything that I want you guys to hear is that God wants your heart. He's looking for your heart, and he wants us to look into our hearts, to challenge us, to ask us some significant questions, to see what captivates us, to see what's really at the center of our lives, like whose name and whose renown really grabs our attention. Whose life are we actually living for? Whose purpose are we really centering our lives around? So what I want to do for the next 4 weeks, or I should say not I, but like what we want to do as a church leadership is to share with you and lay out before you and then invite you into what we believe God is asking all of us as a church here in this present moment to do. We believe God is challenging us and inviting us to steward a move of God by simply living in the perhaps. So what I'm going to do this morning is you're probably going to start to kind of grab hold of some things and be like, whoa, what are we talking about? I'm going to be giving you a lot of information in the days to come. But this morning, what I want to do is share with you the heart behind it all. We're going to give you information regarding the plans and the practicals and of all the things that God is laying out before us. And this plan that we have and what we see coming our way, it involves our campus. It involves our buildings and our facilities because that brings people in. This plan involves a consolidation of our facilities, a repurposing of our campus to better serve the God-given purpose given to us. It's a plan that is absolutely centered on Jesus. It's a plan that is centered on the mission. It's a plan that we believe God has been stirring up in our midst because we've been hearing it in the lives of people. It's been a passage that we've been sharing from day one for the last couple months that God is doing a new thing. It stirs up. See, do you not see it? It's already organically happening. It's a plan that is focused on multi-generational discipleship. It's a plan to partner with other ministries and like-minded nonprofits. A plan that's going to intentionally invest into the emerging generations. And yeah, friends, it's a plan that's going to require faith, joyful generosity and joyful sacrifice as we move towards what it is that God has for us as a church. We believe that God is inviting us into a season of an intentional generosity because generosity reflects the heart of God. And this isn't for our brand. It isn't for the name of Austin Oaks Church. It's not some whimsical man-made plan, but it's because of who we love. And we love Jesus. And we carry the burden that he carries that's on his heart for people who do not know him. So this morning, I'm not going to share with you the plans and all the practicals. I'm not going to give you all the ins and outs and the whys and all the things you can expect. We got events and things that are going to come. And you're going to get information in the weeks to come. But what I'm going to do this morning, and what I feel absolutely compelled to do, in fact, as we were worshiping, I just felt like the Holy Spirit was just like wrestling me and saying, you need to change some things in your message. I want to talk about what does it look like to be captivated by Jesus and why it's important. Why it's important to carry the same passion that God carries in reaching the next generation. You see, the mission that God has given the church from day one, and we heard this a couple of weeks ago, Matthew 28, verse 18 through 20, go into all the world and make disciples. Go into all the world and make disciples, baptizing them. That's evangelism. Help them to meet Jesus. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and then teach them to obey everything I've commanded you, which is the whole life of disciple making. Like, this is the passion. It's been the same end, the same purpose, just a different means, different people, different cultural context, a different time and a different place in the story of Austin Oaks Church. But the mission remains the same. And I want to say something that's gonna sound a little bit bold, but I just feel absolutely compelled to have to say this because, quite frankly, I care for you as your pastor, and I know Jesus does. And so I wanna say something that might be a little offensive. If Jesus doesn't have your heart, if he doesn't have your affections, if he doesn't have your devotion, he doesn't have your life. I'm not saying you're not saved. You very well could be, but I'm gonna let you and the Holy Spirit work on that one. But what I'm saying is, Jesus isn't at your center. And if he's not at your center, his purpose and his burden is not yours. That's why I say he doesn't have your life. And so when you hear passages like Matthew 28, to go into the world and make disciples, baptizing them and teaching other people to obey it, like if he's not at your center and if Jesus doesn't have your heart, then all you focus is on the means and you're gonna go like, I agree or I don't agree, I don't like this or whatever. And so the burden to make disciples isn't a burden you share. It's more of a guilt-inducing thing like, yeah, I should do it, I know I should do it, blah, 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 blah. I'll get to it when I get to it. But if Jesus is the center of all things, and if he does have your heart, you will realize that making disciples is a joyful opportunity that God invites you into. And that means that if Jesus is the center, you're like, yes, Lord, whatever it is, I am going to live in the perhaps because I know, God, you are able to do all things. God, I know you care about every generation. And so I am going to live in kind and I'm gonna let you direct the steps. But if he doesn't have your heart, why does it matter? And here's how I know the difference in my own life. When I know Jesus has my heart, what I'm absolutely passionate about is the end goal. Jesus' name and Jesus' renown. And when I kind of find myself in the center, that's not it. God is a generational God, friends. He's a generational God, and he's passionate about reaching the next generation. It shouldn't come as a surprise that there is a war happening in your midst. And I'm not talking about an economic war, a political war, an international war. I'm talking about a war for the hearts and minds and souls of people. It's a spiritual war. And there is none more fierce than the war after the hearts, souls, and minds of the younger generations. Because the enemy knows that if he can grab them early, and if he can distort the message of Jesus, and if he can taint how people see the church, and if he can get them to think that maybe Christianity is arrogant and oppressive and all these things, and if they can get them at a young age, it will shape and form them. The world, Satan, is phenomenal at disciple making. Phenomenal. There's a war that's going on, and this is why Jesus cares deeply about the emerging generations. Judges 2:10, like you know this, if you ever heard me say anything about like my passion, this is the verse that grabs my heart. And there arose after Joshua and his generation, another generation that did not know the Lord or the things of God. And I always find myself asking the question, how is that possible? Because they just saw Joshua who said in 24 verse 15, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Right? They just saw the promise of entering into the promised land happen. They saw the walls of Jericho fall down. What happened from that generation to this emerging generation? How was there such a drift that happened? Yes, every generation's responsible for their own decisions, but at the same time, the older generations are responsible for passing on the faith to the younger generations. And I believe that scriptures give us a picture of what potentially caused this generational drift. And we also then see a potential framework as to how to invest and how to influence the emerging generations. And I think we can see it in Judges 6:13. If you're taking notes, just write that verse down and you can go back to that. But the angel comes to Gideon, who's like, the people are completely oppressed and they're bitter. They're a little bit resentful. They kind of like forgot the things of God. An angel comes, says to Gideon, hey, I'm asking you to do this. You're mighty man of valor, et cetera, et cetera. And Gideon just says like, well, where is this God of all the things we've heard about? It's like Gideon saying, it's like, yeah, I know the stuff. I heard the stories. Where is he? What difference does it make? And in my interacting with the younger generations, that's what I hear over and over and over. What difference does Jesus make? Really, what difference does he make? Someone tell me. Someone show me. Show me how it's affecting your life. How are you living differently because you love Jesus? Just don't tell me the facts. Friends, millennials, Gen Z, and the Alpha generation, which is a weird name, the Alpha generation, they have more information at their fingertips than anyone else. Now they can just talk to ChatGPT and get the answers to the whole world. Their drifting from Jesus isn't for lack of knowledge. There's a lack of understanding why it matters. And this is why I love God gave us Psalm 78. Psalm 78. So if you have a Bible, turn there. If you got a phone, flip it up. Flip it? Flip it? Flip it up? Dated. Oh my gosh. Remember texting when you had to like hit the number 3 times to get to that letter? Oh, man. Psalm 78, verse 1, 2, and 3. Oh, my people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in parables, and I'm going to utter hidden things, things from old, what we have heard and known, and what our fathers have told us. Asaph is like David's worship leader. And in this psalm, he is like calling out the nation of Israel, which is like me calling out the whole church, like, listen up, pay attention, lean in. It's like when your mother says your full name, Brandon John Ziske, whoop, you got my attention. There's an exclamation point in this punctuation, which is saying like, this is of significance. Give ear. I am going to tell you some significant things. I'm going to open my mouth in parables and utter hidden things, things from old, or another translation said, things from the dark. And this is meant to actually like pique curiosity. A parable is a story with truth that's not explicit, right? It's like you kind of have to read between the lines. And so he's trying to grab the attention of the whole nation. Listen up, because what I'm going to tell you is important. I'm going to say it in a parable. I'm going to say it in truth, but in story form. And what we have here in this psalm from verse 3 through 8 are application points to the psalm. And verse 9 to the end of the psalm is the story. But we're just going to focus on verse 3 through 8. The story of God's faithfulness and his goodness and how we tell it and how we proclaim it and how we live it is significant because the younger generations are watching us, are listening to us, are seeing how we live, why it matters. In verse 3, Asaph goes on like, I will open my mouth in parables. I'm going to utter hidden things, things from old, what we have heard and known and what our fathers have told us. In other words, it's like, he's speaking to the whole nation, but he's got a crowd in mind. He's speaking to those who know the stories, who know the commandments, who can say these things like it's just yesterday, who know the scriptures. He's like, we know them. We are responsible for them. What did they hear from their fathers, the nation of Israel, in this context? What stories were told? Were they just simply told to obey the commands of God? Like, here's the Ten Commandments. This is what we're going to pass on. You shall have no other gods before me, and this and this and this. Honor your father and mother. You shall not steal. You shall make adultery. Got it? Good. Was it all about, like, this is what we do? Well, why do we say the Shema? Why do we say, hear, O Israel, the Lord is one? Because that's just what we do, okay? We just do it. That's what we say. Well, why? It's just what we do. Well, why would we go to church? Because that's just what we do. We go to church on Sunday. But why? Why does it matter? Because that's just... You know, so often, like, when we just want to, like, teach things without understanding the story or the why behind it, do we not just kind of err towards, like, moralism without explaining the heart? What stories were they told? What did you guys learn from your fathers and mothers and guardians and those around you who were older? What did you learn from them? I remember growing up, I never heard the why. I cannot tell you to this day why it was important to go to church growing up. I can remember how many times I was guilted and manipulated to obedience. I can't tell you why. I can't tell you why church was important. Church became an optional thing to me because I never saw how it was impacting my parents' lives at that time or anybody's lives. In fact, when I went to that school growing up, a private school, I didn't see it impact any of the teachers, any of the, like, the principal, the vice principal, nobody. In fact, I saw the opposite. Nobody talked about grace. I'm like, well, what's the point of hearing? He's like, you just got to do this. You got to be a good Christian kid. You got to dress a certain way. You got to say a certain thing. You got to say the creed right. You got to pray right. You got to do this right. And I'm just going, why? Someone tell me why. What are we telling folks behind us? I believe that the gap that happened from Joshua to the story of Judges was that there was this gap where people failed to explain the why. And it just turned into, this is what we do. Look at verse 4 of this psalm. We will not hide them from their children. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders that he has done. We will not hide them. Hide what? That's a great question. We won't hide them, but we will tell them to the next generation. And what is it that they are told to tell the next generation? Like, I'm not trying to be cute here. What you see next is not tell them the commands of God. Tell them how to live right. Tell them how to look Jewish. Tell them how to, no. It was tell them the glorious deeds of God. Tell them the stories of his might. Tell them about the wonders that he has done. Like, when you share Jesus, if the younger generation were to look at your life, like, how would they describe how you explain the story of Jesus? Tell them about what he has done in your life. And I love the fact that it says their children, as if it's to say it takes a church to reach the emerging generations. It's not just mom and dad, but it takes a community of people resolved on this. Like, what do you tell them? There's a place for great doctrine. There's a place for commands, 100%. In fact, we're going to see that next. But I'm telling you, there is something far more powerful and influential when you look at a son or daughter or a student or a child that you are mentoring or serving, and you just say, I want to tell you what Jesus has done in my life. Parents, moms, dads, grandparents, do you wrestle in prayer in front of your kids? You should. They should see you on your knees. That you should even bring them in. Talk to them about it. Why are you wrestling in prayer? Why is this hard for you spiritually? David wasn't afraid of doing that. Scripture says, hey, be honest and vulnerable. Don't hide them from your children. Instead, tell them to the next generation. You need to bring people into your spiritual life to see the difference that Jesus makes. Because if they don't see a life captivated by Jesus, then whatever you tell them and how to live, it will just turn, it will drift into religious performance. Why should we obey Jesus? Why should we obey Jesus? I'm not going to be rhetorical. Why should we obey Jesus? Someone tell me. Why should we obey Jesus? Because we love him. Why do we give? Because we love him. Why do we struggle in prayer? Because we love him. Why do I go to my kids and apologize when I lost it? Because I love him. And I want them to know that. I want to be able to connect that why with why and how we should live as a Christian and why these ways matter. When it says, do not hide them, friends, come on, let's just be honest. The easy thing to do is just to get moral compliance. To teach people and say to your kids and say to the younger generations, this is what we do. We don't do this. We don't vote this way. We don't act this way. Dare, that's a Christian. That's the easy thing to do. And quite frankly, the church does not hide from doing that. But what we hide from is investing our lives into them. Because that means you have to get close. You have to be raw. You have to be vulnerable. You have to be transparent. You have to give. You have to sacrifice. You have to make a way. You got to realize that it doesn't revolve around you. So, friends, you should not ever forget what God has done in your life. You want to know how to make a difference generationally? You tell people what God has done in your life. You tell them why. You share that. The ups and the downs. Sometimes there's nothing more powerful than saying to someone who doesn't know Jesus, be like, I struggle with God here. And I don't get God here. I don't understand this. Oh, really? You don't? But what I do know is that God is good, that God is loving, and God is faithful, and he's all-knowing. I can trust him. And let me tell you where I've seen that. In fact, Moses, in Deuteronomy 6, verse 20, this is great. Deuteronomy 6, verse 20, he says, there's going to come a time, parents, grandparents, when your children are going to come and ask you, what's the meaning of all of this? In other words, like, Mom, Dad, why do we go to church? And Moses says, tell them this. And what proceeds is the story. It's the story. This is why. Look what God has done. In the order of this psalm, in verse 5, he says, yes, decreed statutes for Jacob, established the law. Yes, there are things to obey, commands and doctrines and all that kind of stuff, which is great. But church, listen, we in the West, we love doctrine, we love truth, we love all that stuff. But if your doctrine doesn't cause you to have a greater love for Jesus, be careful. That's the same thing that Jesus called out to the church in Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2. Oh, you know all the stuff, but you've forgotten or you've abandoned your first love. Why does this matter? Why does this matter? Verse 6, 7, and 8. So the next generation would know them. Even the children yet to be born, and in turn would tell their children. Four generations represented right there. Then they would put their trust in God, and then would not forget his deeds, and would keep his commands. They would not be like their forefathers, a stubborn, rebellious generation whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not faithful to them. Why does it matter to not hide the things that God has done in your life? And why does it matter for a church to be focused on declaring these things to the emerging generation? We see three things very clearly so that they would put their hope in God. They would trust in him. They wouldn't forget the works of God. and they would keep his commands. But here's the thing. They would keep his commands not out of bitterness, out of spite, out of resentment, but out of joyful love, because they now know the why and they are beginning to experience it themselves. That's why I love Amanda's story. It's like she experienced and heard the why through multiple people here at Austin Oaks Church. And when she drifted, what brought her back was, oh yeah, Jesus. So friends, I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to fall in love with Jesus. Be absolutely captivated by him. And if your heart is cold, I say to you, like I said at Easter, look at the throne. Look at him. Look at what he has done. Remember it. Embed it on your heart. Embed it on your mind. And church, as we continue to move with God as a church to impact tomorrow, today, as we strive to steward this move of God that's here, I want to encourage you, invite the younger generations into your spiritual journey, into your life, the highs and the lows, all of it. Live it out in front of them. Don't hide it. Don't just keep it at mere words. Show them. Do it with them. Model it. Get in children's ministry. Serve the youth. Man, there's so many ways. But I think more than anything, what matters most is just a resolve of heart. Choose to make a difference. Choose to make a difference. Choose that Jesus is the center and that his purpose and his ambition really should be the purpose and ambition of your life. And I want to come back to these plans and the practicals of what we're going into in this season. One of the specific plans and purposes that we have is specifically dealing with this concept of how do we do a better job of reaching the emerging generations? How do we foster greater multi-generational discipleship connections? I can't wait to share with you some of this information and these plans. We believe this is what God is doing. But I don't want to get into any of that, because if we don't get this right, all of that means nothing. All of this means nothing. So I want to wrap up this time by celebrating communion together. Because as we come together around the elements, this is part of remembering the why, isn't it? Why are we here? Jesus gave himself. His body was broken. His blood was shed. Hebrews 12 tells us that it was with joy that was set before him that he endured the cross, that he went to the cross, because he loved us. He wanted us to enter into a relationship with him. And in the context of these generational moments, I don't know if you remember, but about a year ago this time, we were talking about multi-generational connections, and we were talking about how it's important for the older generations to show the younger generations that Jesus is worth it. And I remember asking Miss Mary Bowles to come up to the stage, and I got a picture of this. And I was just like, Mary, what would you just say to the younger generations? And her answer was, Jesus is just better. 90 plus years old, y'all. She's been there. Highs, lows, joys, sorrows, multiple changes, multiple transitions. But because of what Jesus has done and how she's seen life transformation in her life in her children's life, in the lives of other people, seeing emerging generations become captivated by Jesus. This is her life story. This is the legacy she wants to leave behind. Jesus is just better. And I want you to be thinking about that as we celebrate communion. So let's go ahead and rip the top off so we can. Paul says, I received from the Lord what I pass on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took the bread. And he took it. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. And he said, this is my body given to you. Take and eat. And then he took the cup, saying that this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. And I love this verse, because whenever you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. Let's take together. Judges 2:10, there arose another generation that did not know the Lord. Church, can we say together, like truly, can we say together, that won't happen on our watch? Jesus, you gave it all. So help us and stir us up to give it all back. Not on our watch. And so, church, I want to encourage you just to stand with me. So you can stand now. And I want you to say along with me just these two verses. And in essence, like these two verses, I kind of want it to be a sense of like a pledge that we're making to the Lord. The first verse is Isaiah 26, verse 8. The second part, where it says, your name and renown are the desires of our heart. Church, let's say that together as a pledge we are making to the Lord. Your name and renown are the desire of our hearts. And then Psalm 78, verse 4. Let's say this together. We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders he has done. Jesus, I thank you for your word. And I thank you that you invited us for such a time as this. Lord, there's always a time and place for information and plans and details. But Lord, none of that matters if you don't have our heart. Lord, I pray that you, but through the power of the Holy Spirit, which is captivate our hearts, grow our love for you, our affection for you, our devotion to you. May we find joy in worshiping you. May we find joy in giving, and joy in being generous, joy in sacrifice, joy in serving. Lord, may we be a church that lives for your name and your renown, that it would be told of us years down the road that look at what they did. Lord, I pray that we as a church would not hide the beauty of the gospel. And Lord, I pray that you would give us experiences and moments and times where we can reflect and see your goodness and your faithfulness in our lives. Lord, we pray for the emerging generations. We pray, Lord, that you would capture their hearts. Lord, we pray that you would protect them from the enemy that is out to kill them, to destroy them, to keep them blinded to the truth. Lord, we pray that you would cause a revival and a renewal to sweep up your people, sweep up the younger generations. May they shine like stars, Lord. God, would you be so gracious and favorable to use us? May we be found worthy to be used to turn that tide, Lord. God, I pray that you would stir in our hearts as a church to give you our predetermined yes. Lord, I ask that you would just take the words of this song that come from our hearts as a pleasing sacrifice to you. In Christ's name. Amen. As we conclude this service today, I want to give you some information regarding some of the plans and the information that's going to come out. I want to let you know that we will be talking more about this plan as God is inviting us to steward this move of God. But first and foremost, I want to begin to invite you on a journey of prayer, okay? I have a slide. I'm not sure if it's there, but it's like we want to encourage you to download this app called Echo, okay? I want you to download that app, Echo, and then look for the little, if you hit the main menu, there's going to be a feed button. Hit that button and search Austin Oaks Church, okay? Because on there, you're going to start to see all of the prayer requests and things that we're going to be praying for specifically in this season. So I want to encourage you to join us on that. And also, I want you to start thinking about how you can join us in a prayer movement that's going to be coming towards the end of this month, in April 25th through the 28th. We as a church, we're going to be committed to praying for 72 hours straight. You'll get information on that down the road. But also, I want to encourage you, please, church, hear me, please, attend every Sunday this month. You can do it, okay? And if you can't be here physically, watch it online. Because each Sunday, we're going to be unfolding more and more of the plans and the initiative that we are entering into, okay? I want to encourage you to do that. Next two Sundays, we have informational meetings that are going to unpack all of the details, and then we're going to have a Q&A session to provide clarity, but also just to kind of like wet the whistle a little bit. We got pictures and plans that are out there in the foyer, so I want to encourage you to join others to see that. There'll be people there to talk with you as well. But if you need prayer this morning, specifically regarding your heart, regarding is Jesus the one that captivates you, regarding discipleship, regarding the concept of purpose in life, I want to encourage you, if you need prayer this morning, come on up. Our prayer team would love to pray with you. But if there's any other needs in your life, if there's sickness, if there's illness, if there's financial, if there's relational strain, whatever it is, please don't leave here without being prayed for. We also want to encourage just fellowship as well. So, church, we are excited for this season. Be blessed and have a great week.
So